I literally
oh, see the message. Did you send them a Zoom invite?
No, I thought you were doing that.
That's why. Okay. How long are you doing this now? I forgot you were here. Ready? You sure?
Let's get into it then. We'll make a start.
Discover Music NI.
Welcome to Discover Music NI. My name's Kendo. With me, as always, is Corky. What's the crack, Corky?
Hello, Kendo. How are you?
Evening. Good to see you. What's happening?
What's quiet? Good to see yourself. Thanks very much for coming along.
I'm not so bad. I haven't changed much since I last spoke to you, but anyhow.
No, that's true.
You want to let us know what we've got tonight, then?
Yes, tonight we have some great music coming up. And that's always all I have to say. No, I'm not joking. Yes, tonight where we have some great music from Ferrells and Warren Ellis, and we will be joined by a couple of guys from Modern Rome who are our featured guests this evening. I know we've got Danny. I'm not sure who else is joining Danny, but we'll see. Be surprised.
A and other,
exactly. That guy. I like that guy.
That guy. So, Courtney, we're going to get kicked off tonight with Ferrells on a track called Separate.
The coronavirus is the biggest threat this country has faced for decades.
Because of all we've done, the risk to the American people remains very low.
I shook hands with everybody, you'll be pleased to know. And
if you're healthy, you will probably be fine.
Anyone who can't work from home should be actively encouraged to go to work.
Put my heart under a hammer. Smash away these feelings, cut the strings. Separate, separate. She pulls out the top drawer, packs her things in a red suitcase, and she's gone. There is no feeling, there is no feeling anymore. Are you useless? Are you useless? Living substance, no excuses. All my I wanna live up to expectations, 'cause there's no feeling anymore. There is no separation. There is no separation. There is no separation. There is no separation. Put my heart under a hammer. Smash away these feelings, cut the strings. Separate, separate, separate.
Crack and start.
Great song. Great song.
Love that tune. Those guys, they're a three-piece originally from the North Coast, but they're now residing in Belfast, I believe, and self-proclaimed loudest band of Belfast, according to their social media there. So it's good start, good start.
It is. I'd well believe it. And as you said, that's a great start.
So right, Corks, what do you got lined up for us now?
We have acoustic singer-songwriter Rory Nellis, originally from Belfast. Coming up is a song called January.
Yeah, and another good song there. I was just reading his bio, and I was just telling you about it there before. It just says that he was actually inspired by Ferris Bueller to write songs. So that's kind of cool, actually.
That is, yes. Very folk, obviously. So does, like you mentioned, Nick Drake. You can hear Nick Drake.
Yeah, there's elements there. Just the very soft vocals there just would remind you a little bit of Nick Drake and that style of music as well. Just, yeah. Really very easy listening, but yeah, very cool.
Definitely good stuff. We're looking forward to hearing more from him. I think that's January came out there just recently. I guess his latest single,
start of the year. Yeah, that just came out the start of the year. Ironically
in January. You know, yeah. We must do more research on that.
We should.
Maybe a good way to start with that.
Yeah,
good stuff.
We're not amateurs.
No, definitely not, obviously. Stuff. Yes, so great song again. I mean, that's two great songs to start with, and two opposite ends of the scale as well. So good start. We will then bring in our guest, have joined us. Please welcome Modern Room.
So yeah, guys, welcome. As we said, good to have you on. Thanks for taking a bit of time out and coming here and having a chat. When we say coming here, it's like virtual space and all that as it is at the moment.
Yeah.
So if you want to start, just tell us a little bit about yourselves, where you're from, how you get into music, that kind of thing.
I mean, we grew up in Bangor, and that's sort of how we knew each other from school. So it's been quite a long time. We've been we've known each other, and then I think, you know, from even like late primary school, you know, we were attempting to do some musical things together. Like I say attempting, because like I remember we have some very early recordings of us playing like Tom on the keyboard, myself on the cello, and it was incredibly bad. But there was a certain, you know, I think there's just, there's certain element that was like, you know, we're trying to make our own music. And I think that's probably just, I suppose that's what started off our sort of working together on music. And then steadily from then, like throughout our grammar school, we were, you know, collaborating within bands and working on music. So yeah, it's been, it's funny. Yeah, it's been very good for us, I guess, in like, it's been a long time we've had to sort of work on things together and sort of develop that, I suppose, that sort of teamwork in terms of like working on music.
Excellent.
I don't know.
Yeah, a long road you've been coming on to find out what sort of music you actually want to make, I suppose.
Yeah, exactly. I think it definitely still is continuing.
Excellent.
Mm-hmm. That's definitely something we, I think actually it's almost the more you sort of work on music together, the more you then find that you want to like maybe evolve your style or something like that. You know, so I think it's definitely, and when I think about the type of music that we've done over the years, you know, it's always been changing in terms of genre and sort of style and things like that.
Pretty good. Excellent. Tom, have you anything to follow up on that? Has Danny covered everything off there?
Pretty much, yeah. So we had our band. We had a band when we were in school that was kind of like a ska slash sort of a bit of funk, a bit of everything, really kind of doing a lot of covers and stuff, which was fun. And then that sort of died a death towards the end of school when people started moving away and getting girlfriends and what have you. So
the
then
worst it, thing for a band.
It really is. Then throughout uni, we kept talking about, oh, we need to do something else. We need to start another band. And it just didn't really materialize because sort of other distractions got in the way, you know, when you're at uni and you're going out a lot and not everything else.
Were you at the same university or were you different?
We were, yeah. And we both at Queens and we lived together as well. So there was no excuse really to not form a band. But yeah, it was just in our last year we finally said, right, let's actually do this.
Excellent. So
recruited a couple of guys that we knew, very good musicians, and sort of we've been going since then.
Excellent.
It's sort of strange to me that like we were sort of at this point where we're like, okay, we're finally living together, you know, like we should have all the time, we're in uni, we should have all this free time to sort of work on music. But I don't know, it just, it took right until the very end and we were like, oh God, what have we spent like our 3 or 4 years doing? We're like, okay, let's actually bring some things together. But I think like in another sense, it's been, I suppose we almost like felt like we needed to reach a level of like, I don't know, organization or maturity where we're ready to be sort of like, okay. And that's something we're still working on, is trying to actually sort of run the band and run like our social media and stuff. I don't know if I would have been really ready to do that when I was just starting uni.
Yeah.
Not that I even know I'm ready to do it now, but do your best.
A lot of other things going on at the time as well, trying to juggle everything. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned you played cello and Tom keyboard and things like that, and then the ska band and all these sorts of things. So influences then, what were your influences? There's quite a diversity there from what you said already.
Yeah, I mean, so at the time when we formed the kind of ska band, like my main influences were like The Clash, The Jam, kind of punk that incorporated brass instruments. So that was where I was at the time. But sort of when we started Modern Rome, I was sort of really in the kind of moody alt rock singer songwriter kind of space. I was listening to a lot of Radiohead, which was one of my favorite bands growing up, but kind of got back into them. And like a lot of singer songwriters like Nick Drake and Joni Mitchell and stuff, but I wanted to combine that with a kind of a rock sound as well. So
cool
stuff.
I could say sort of similarly. I'm trying to think like back. Oh yes. I think, I suppose an important musical development for me was like But about the time we were doing this ska band, I joined like the school jazz band and stuff like that. And I think that sort of had a big impact because you're like, oh my goodness, there's brass instruments, you know, you can, and I think a lot of people can sort of, I'm sure a lot of people can relate, like doing jazz band at school is probably like, I suppose, a big part of your sort of musical life at that point. So I think that's definitely where that came from. But then, yeah, as I, throughout like university, I suppose, I was listening to maybe a lot more like sort of power pop, pop rock, like Jellyfish, or like I was listening to a lot of David Bowie. So I think that sort of has taken or sort of my side of Modern Room. I think that's sort of influenced the sound a bit.
Excellent.
Yeah, cool.
Good stuff. Nice what we'll do then is we're going to play your first song. I don't know if you want to play, which one you want to play first. I have the two songs. Is there a preference?
Shall we go with Real first? New single?
Yeah, I think it's best to do the new single first, yeah.
Cool, no worries. So yes, here it comes, and this is Real.
Just
my life on the screen. The least I could be, a man who could say he's real and feel like you do. Just a slave to the sea. Spend my life on the screen. The least I could be, a man who could say he's real and feel like you do. Just a slave to the sea. Spend my life on the screen. The least I could be, a man who could say he's real and feel like you do. Just a slave to the sea.
It's a great song.
Brilliant song, lads.
Well, thank you very much.
Talking over each other as usual. Brilliant song. Yeah, really enjoyed that.
I think you're so used to like listening to the track over and over again, trying to listen to like, make notes about it for like mixing or whatever.
Yeah.
So it's nice to like just sit and sort of like listen to
and
it
not
as a whole.
Critique without... it and each time.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. At least there's we can't make any more changes now anyway. Yeah. So
I've listened to it quite a few times actually, knowing obviously you were coming on and so on, but just listening it again there now, I'm just going to myself, I couldn't put my finger on it before, but there's elements of Ben Folds in there for me. You know, very strong keys and stuff like that. I was going, it's just triggered with me there now.
Yeah, I've been sort of, it was actually kind of late. It was a few years ago. I just really, because I'd heard like Underground or like a few times, but then just a few years ago, I really, really got into just that album, Ben Folds 5 album. And they're so good. So yeah, they're definitely, I think in terms of like bringing, because we always had keyboards, but like when we started, we also had a lead guitar player. So it was very much quite a dense sound, but like, yeah, I think that from my side anyways, like made me think about bringing the keyboards quite front and center.
Yeah, very, very prominent. Works so well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think as well, like, Ben Folds like voice is quite like characteristic, and it's almost like a musical theater style aspect to his singing. And I like that. I like this. There's sort of almost like a quite a vulnerability to it or something that I quite like.
Yeah, because I was thinking to myself, going, you know, who does it remind me of and stuff, and I was sort of going Divine Comedy, but then I was like, no, not lyrically or anything like that, because they kind of go off on a comic storytelling kind of a thing, which isn't the case for you guys, you know.
And with that song, sounds like there's a story in that song as well. It's not a slave to the scene. I am real. Was that particularly about anything? It sounds quite
well. I mean, I think most of my songs since we started Modern Room, they're sort of about like the sort of the reality that we find ourselves in, trying to like, you know, just I suppose trying to make music and be relatively successful, like trying to, it's sort of this balance of like whether you're getting fulfillment through like making the music or you know, sometimes we find ourselves in the position where like, or I feel at least personally that like, I'm not so concerned. I'm like, oh yeah, we'll make the song and I like the song. But what I'm actually really so concerned about is like people listening to it or blogs reviewing it or people in like the music scene liking it. And like, you're probably, I know, even though I know it's probably not the best idea because I'm going to set myself up to be disappointed. But you sort of find those thoughts creeping in a lot. So that song is just really about how, you know, and I'm sure, I think people in any sort of creative position can see this, but you get into this habit of really chasing like just a success on social media or something, when it's so difficult that like, if you can just take some sort of fulfillment from having fun doing the music in the band, that's probably a healthier way to do it.
Doing it more for yourself as opposed to doing it for other people then.
Yeah, I think you have to, and I don't think I've achieved that yet. But it's something that I try to like Because I would like us to be a success, because I think that would be great. But you know, I think it's just even doing, like, we've done like 5 singles now, and I think that's really cool to have just some. We have this music out that's ours, you know.
6 singles, I believe.
Oh, 6 singles. Thanks, Tom. I was saying, it's amazing. 6.
Just gotta plug them, you know.
There's always somebody keeping a record up here. Absolutely. Always.
Yeah,
but no, it's a very good song, and as Kendall was saying there too, that's what I thought. I was listening to it today when I was supposed to be doing some work, and that's what I was kind of thinking. Is it a case of, was it kind of like a retort to it? Maybe you feel like you're not writing music for you anymore, you're trying to write it for somebody else, and it's a wee bit of a retort back to that, to say, well, actually, no, hang on, this music's for me. I'm making the music I want to make, and it kind of, that's the impression I got.
Yeah. Today. Yeah, I think that's totally valid, and I think it's that, and that's in a way, because you know, if we were operating from a position where we're saying we're not satisfied with just making this music for ourselves, and we are only satisfied if we are getting like some, you know, local radio play or just radio play at all, or you know, blogs reviewing it, then you are going to be moving to a place where you are just writing songs because you think they will like do well in the algorithm or something like that. So I don't think that's I think you can do things that are like a good business sense. Yes. But you know, you still want to write music that you enjoy or you find fulfilling in some way.
Yeah, well,
yeah, definitely.
That's absolutely. It's I've been in a couple of bands before, and from listening to that, I was picking out the bass quite a lot, because I played, although I wouldn't say I'm a bass player, I would say I'm a guitarist, but I've played bass a couple of times, and
good man.
that's the thing that I always picked up on was the bass, and I listened to a lot of music. And I find myself kind of sort of struggling with myself a bit. You're not a bass player, but you're listening to all the bass. Stop doing that. Listen to the guitar.
I find that with drums. Like, I'm a guitarist mostly, but really all I want to do is play drums, and that's what I'm listening to, and that's what I'm obsessed over.
Did you play drums before this? Did you learn drums first or anything like that?
No. I mean, I've bought an electric drum kit just
for nice,
you know, for fun, but. No, I've never played drums in a band or anything.
Well, I'm glad to hear someone's listening out to my bass.
And as the bass player, it's about 10 years ago now, I was in a band with a couple of mates, and I can't remember what it was. One of the guys sent me a video or something. It was the bass player is, there's the lead singer, and then there's the guitarist. The lead singer's the front man, and he gets all the women on us.
Yeah.
The lead guitarist, the show off. And the drummer's the crazy one, and then the bass player's the other guy. I could stick about this for such a long time, but it was just what it was, you know. and do you find
that? Oh yeah, well, I think it's like you sort of definitely in my case, then it's like, oh, I make up for that because I sang on that track, and we, Tom and I, share sort of vocal duties. But yeah, like I get to be the diva front man and the bass player at the same time, because I'm like, I wouldn't be, it's like my ego's too high to just sit in the back and play bass.
Well, that's fair enough.
Yeah, it's like this podcast. It's like this podcast. Corky's the other guy in this podcast too.
Yeah.
This is brand new information.
Yeah, like me being PR, that was brand new information tonight too.
Okay. And is it just the two of you used to do the songwriting? Do any other guys contribute?
They would contribute from a kind of arrangement and production standpoint, but in terms of songwriting, it's the two of us. Yeah, pretty good.
And so on, I'd be quite interested in, do you do that together or separately or sometimes both?
It's kind of changed over the years. Certainly when we were younger, there was a lot more of the kind of sitting in a room together, working on something from scratch. Well, maybe one of us would bring like a rough idea, but we would mostly do most of it together. But sort of in later years, it has been more separate, where one of us would basically write the entire song, like, you know, chords, melody, lyrics, and then we would bring it to the other one, which I think, you know, the music we make is very kind of personal, very like emotional, and I think it just works better that way. I don't know, because the kind of lyrics we would write when we were younger were generally either abstract or completely stupid. So the kind of stuff we write now, which is more personal, you know, it's just works better to write it
Would you start off with the lyrics, or would you start off with like a melody or a couple of chords and then get started from there?
I pretty much always start with the music, just because
I really like to meet people who start with the lyrics, because like those people, I feel like most people, unless you're like Elton John or something.
I've done that a couple of times.
I find it just so hard to like, I find I never have like inspiration for lyrics, and then I'm like, oh, I'd like to put this to music. Usually for me, like when I'm writing music, it's like I'll have this idea that comes to me, which is probably like based on some song that I'm really enjoying. I'm like, oh, I like this sort of the vibe that this song has given me. I'd really like to write a song that has this sort of similar vibe. And then afterwards I'll be like, okay, you know, what is something that I'm interested in writing about, or some sort of idea I've had in my head. Let's try to write some lyrics that fit it.
Yeah. No, I was going to say, just, you always hear of some of these songwriters and so on, and they have these notebooks and they're just filled with lyrics, but they've no music to go with it. So it's always interesting to hear, you know, how different bands approach it, or different singers, you know, approach it, you know, what way they do it. Because, and then you're saying, going, I want to meet somebody that can do it that way, that's got like a ton of lyrics.
Yeah. I think it's, that would be very handy. One of our favorite artists, one of our favorite bands, Elbow, like I remember saying things about Guy Garvey, like he had these notebooks full of like poetry basically. And I suppose that makes sense if you're a poet and then you're sort of putting that to music. But I think I would love to have like that as a skill. I think that would be amazing to be like, you're not necessarily writing your songs just because you have to, because you need to put some words to this music. I think it would be really great to just be so sort of inspired to write this poetry. But just at the moment, that's just not how it works for me.
Yeah, Guy Garvey is just one of those guys. It just flows. The lyrics just come out of him, I think. He's able to express himself in that way. Like,
I think bring it back to the regarding this song, one song in particular from, I think it's Cast of Thousands. It's Fugitive Motel, which has this sort of like ethereal 3/4. I don't know if it is 3/4 or 6/8. I think it's 3/4, but that's I suppose an example where I heard this song Fugitive Motel, and I always wanted to write a song that sort of had this similar feeling of like, I don't know, just this expansive feeling that song has. So that was one of the things I would have been like, okay, oh, how can I replicate that sort of feeling without completely plagiarizing it?
Happy days.
I mean, you can hear that in the song too. You know, I really enjoyed the start of it too. And I suppose a little bit similar, I pick up on a lot of drums now, where it starts, they kind of build up at the very start and you hear them coming on the heavy, and then it kicks off from there. And it all sounds very grand. It sounds like you've like a huge orchestra behind you almost, you know, it's that kind of grandeur about it. So it does. But yeah, it's a fantastic song, guys. And when was that released? You said it's your new single.
Yeah, that was released on the 19th of March, so quite recently.
That kind of brings us to the natural next step. We asked you for a second song as well, if you'd like to introduce that for us, please.
So the next song we've picked is The Guillotine, which was 2 singles ago, back in August, I believe. Was it August?
August, yeah.
Yeah, which is quite an old song and actually dates back to that ska band. And really? So it's nothing like ska. It kind of signaled where it was a song that came sort of at the end of that band's existence, and kind of signaled where we wanted to go. So maybe had we not had that break, we would have started doing this kind of music a lot earlier. But yeah, we brought it back for this band just because it was one that had always kind of stuck with us, and one that our friends liked a lot, which, you know, is an influence when, you know, your friends are like, oh,
yeah,
that one song you wrote, I really like that. So
yeah, you're not going
to kind of want to play it live because people will respond to it.
Yeah.
So yeah. Thank you.
In silence I await my punishment, my fire. It burnt so bright I could no longer distinguish wrong from right. But there was no chance to explain. They already knew who was to blame, and she reassembles the scene. As you sharpen the guillotine, and I hear the whispering voices, they ridicule my impulsive choices. Razor blade eyes, all staring at me, left out in the rain.
Another brilliant song there, lads. Oh,
thank you.
I was
really enjoyed that.
I was just smirking there at the end because I remembered it just did that the very sort of like the very last time it goes around, just like quite sort of in the background there's this like sort of yelling and screaming, and I had just done that was just me like screaming in a room. But when we'd sent it to the mix, the guy who's mixing the track, he was sort of amused because it was just three tracks named like Crazed Screaming 1, 2, and 3. Like, I just like by themselves they were so deranged sounding, but they're sort of bedded in there, so it's not.
That's good. It adds a bit of character to the song as well, so it
does, yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, that's what we usually do when we're like, oh, we want to add a bit more oomph. We just like either Tom will get the guitar and starts going just start hitting the guitar.
Yeah, there's some of that in there too.
Start yelling. Yeah.
Not improvisation.
Yeah, absolutely. That's another great song, guys. It is. It's such a massive sound there as well. You know, it's again picking up on your bass as well, and even the bass on your keyboard as well. Like all those bottom end notes, and even the like floor toms and the kick drum and all that kind of stuff going off too. That will pull me in straight away. I was hooked.
Yeah, I think that's something maybe that like, because obviously we, as we were saying, we write the song separately, but something I suppose that sort of brings it together is because we both sort of want an impactful sound, sort of an expansive sound with the songs. And obviously it depends on the song, but one of the thing, I suppose the main sort of thing in it is that we want it to be like engaging or like, and sort of, yeah, impactful, I guess, and a big sound, which and I think that sort of is a common theme throughout the singles.
Yeah, definitely, very good. I really enjoyed too, just before kind of your last couple of choruses there, instead of, there was a cello coming and played like a...
Yeah,
like
that's a, right, yeah.
I thought that was really good and was really interesting, instead of having like a guitar coming in there, just for that wee bit of uniqueness in it. I thought this, and it sounded really, really good in the mix as well.
We were just trying to get something that I suppose is a little different texture-wise.
I was just going
to
say, yeah, it's kind of a common sort of theme through our music, certainly our more recent music, that we generally don't give the melodies to the guitar, just because we just want to do something a bit different, and generally it will go to the piano or to the cello or both.
Excellent. No, good stuff. It sounds great there.
It helps to create that kind of a little bit more uniqueness, you know, to make, you know, that you're not sounding like every other guitar band out there, or, you know, and, you know, it's giving you that sort of, if you want, like a unique selling point, if you will, you know.
Well, that's the way we sound, yeah. There's that, as you were saying earlier, like trying to get that sense of grandeur, and there is almost like an orchestral sort of vibe that maybe like an image that the piano and cello conjure up, whereas like if you were to just have sort of roaring guitars, like maybe we would have in the past, you don't necessarily get that same feeling.
Yeah, it's good that you obviously, I think, as yourself, Danny plays the cello.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. I try to anyway.
But it's good that, you know, like you have that as well. Obviously, as you say, the both you grew up in doing brass bands and all this kind of stuff, jazz bands and all. And it's good too that, because like for me, I play a guitar. And that's it. Mm-hmm. I have a wee keyboard here. I'm trying to teach myself a wee bits. I can't play anything. I can play the Super Mario theme. That's about it.
That's all you need.
That's good.
And yeah. It's one of those things where I don't have the discipline, the self-discipline, and the patience. I've learned a couple of things. I learned to play Desperado by the Eagles. I learned to play Richard Marx. I can't even mind the name of the song now. Don't get me wrong. I'm not going to play it. I'm not going to embarrass myself with that. But two or three things. I couldn't do it. I'll get so nervous about it.
You know, this show's not about you.
So you keep telling me. so what I keep saying as well.
You know, I was in general last year, I just before all the gigs went away and everything, I was sort of like, oh, I'm tired of, like, not to say I was like getting to do gigs all the time, but I was doing quite a few gigs. And I was just like kind of tired of like the classic, you know, just all the rigmarole with like setting up stuff. And then, but one thing I really, really miss is just like being able to chat with other bands who are in like the same spot that we are, or just other people who are doing like stuff to do with local music. And you sort of get to have that sort of solidarity or whatever. You're like, oh yeah, it's, you know, you're both struggling with the same things. So that's one of the things. I mean, I think because obviously you're saying, you know, you've been in bands yourself, I think you can sort of identify with that as well.
I've noticed that quite a bit actually, through looking up for bands and listening to songs and everything else. You can see there's a little communities here and there where, you know, you'll go and look at a band and they're friends with another band, and they've either somebody's sang on one of their songs or vice versa, or they've shared some of their stuff and, you know, all this sort of stuff. So you see all these little, and you know, and then from talking to bands, you go, oh, we were gigging with these or that, you know. It's like, as you say, you miss that because there's that camaraderie there that's, you're missing out on that.
Definitely,
and then you get you pick up your little bits of influences from hearing the band playing in a certain way or doing a certain thing, or going, oh, we might try that in a track, or, you know, these little things as well.
Mm-hmm. That's actually something I haven't really thought about, but like, yeah, seeing other bands play live and you're like, God, that particular like thing they did live was really, really good. Like, why aren't we doing something like that? Obviously, I guess we aren't working on our live sets, so it doesn't matter as much, but even just musically, I think, you know, getting to hear other people play is, it's something, it sucks that we can't sort of experience that at the moment.
Yeah, the two of us is basically how our relationship is, basically mostly through going to gigs, and that's one thing we've been talking about these last couple of days. Going, I can't wait to go and see a band again.
Yeah, I know. Can't come too soon.
No, yeah, definitely. Big time.
Well, that's it. I think it'll be good. You know, at the first. So the first time we're able to gig again, we'll be like, right, you've no excuse. You haven't seen us in 2 years or whatever.
Exactly.
You'll have to come into the gig.
There's going to be so many people and other bands as well. That's, you know, we've a gig in 3 weeks' time. What are we going to do between now and then? Right, we'll do your practice and everything's normal, but let's go see these guys. Let's go, oh, they're playing there on Friday night, and then these guys are playing here on Saturday night. But, you know, I can see it happening where, not, you know, yourselves and other bands, everybody's going to go out and see everybody else play as well. And as you say, it kind of leads back to that sort of the community of, you know, you've gigged with other people, you know, you've shared equipment, things like this, and just basically supported each other as well, you know, in that kind of sense. And it's going to be great for you guys to be able to get out and do that again and have other people do that with you as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I can see in that actually becoming bigger for you for bands now, is that everybody will be looking to support everybody else because you're all in it together.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's in another sense, yeah, it's harder to maybe support each other like just in a small way online, because I mean you can share stuff, but it's I don't know, you just, I suppose it's not so much of a direct contact with people.
Kind of leading on from there then, something we're asking a lot of guests we've had on so far is about good or bad gigs that either you've been to or that you've played at. Opens up quite an interesting conversation, so it does.
I'm trying to think of bad gigs. We've had like, interesting people. There was like, we went, and this was actually a great gig. I just thinking off the top of my head, we went down to Drop Dead Twice in which is a bar in Dublin, and I thought it was so great that they were putting on bands from like the north, and basically I can't remember if they were like paying us or whatever, but they weren't charging us, which I think is really good,
because
like it's kind of hard to put on a gig down south if you know you're gonna have to pay and then you're like not even sure if people are gonna come. But I just remember there was someone in attendance who, I think it was during the week as well, but there was a woman who was there who had must have started quite early, but yeah, the Garda had to come in to take her out because they wouldn't serve her any more drinks, and she was going behind the bar to get drinks, and at one point she flashed the stage, which I missed. But yeah, our poor drummer Josh was pretty traumatized.
I can imagine.
He was talking about it for weeks afterwards.
Yeah, but I mean, in some ways, you know, there were people at that gig, so in some ways, you know, that's a good experience. We have done many a gig where it's been pretty pretty quiet, but sometimes at those gigs, like I remember, we went up to Lurgan to Fadjo's, expecting, you know, it's middle of the week in Lurgan, but actually the people who were there were really, really supportive and really interested. They actually were actively listening to what we were playing. And it was, so what we thought was going to be like, ah, oh, we'll do the gig. And, you know, we don't feel in a position to be like, oh, we're too good to do a place. But in the end, it turned out to be a really, really good experience.
Excellent. Well, cool. those turn out to be the best nights. You go there with little expectation.
Yeah.
And as you say, everybody was engaging. Everybody was keen on it. And then you've had a great night out of it.
Mm-hmm.
Go, Corks. Go ahead.
No, go ahead after you.
No, I was just going to say, leading on from that, we're talking about, we've obviously been talking about, you know, gigging with other bands and so on. We've asked you to bring a recommended artist with you, or well, bring it with you, but you know what I mean. share with us tonight. If you'd like to maybe tell us a little bit about this artist and then introduce the song for us, please.
Well, this artist is Mark Hegan, a very good friend of both of ours, who I went to school with. We've played in bands with him in the past, and he sort of started as a solo artist just about a year and a half ago, mm-hmm. and he's brought out about five phenomenal singles. But this most recent one is quite, it's simultaneously like his most poppy, but also his most kind of strange. Like there's a lot of kind of interesting rhythmic elements and stuff. It's just, it's got his kind of trademark passion and like melancholy. It's just a really great song.
Excellent. Good stuff. The track is called We Don't Need Another Miracle, and here it comes.
Dream of a new life, love.
Great recommendation, guys.
Really, yeah, it's really cool.
Absolutely.
Agreed.
I love just all the, like, you know, the bits with the bass coming in. It's very percussive in a way, the sort of bass. Obviously, that's, you know, what I'm listening out for. But yeah, I think, you know, it's funny because I could imagine Mark having written a song like that. And when I think back to the songs when we played in bands with him and things, I can hear similarities, but it's just like, the sort of quality of production and everything has just evolved so much. It's really, really great to hear.
Yeah.
And I think for us listening to that, like, I know I've, and this is one of the things we're talking about, collaboration, you know, it's been really great to, we've had a lot of chats with Mark just about, you know, working on music or working on social media. And like, he's really someone who's interested in doing things that in a way where he's doing what he wants and it's his artistic vision, but in a smart way where he's not sort of like banging his head against a brick wall. So I think it's been really helpful for us to have his sort of perspective on things as well.
Yeah, that's cool.
It always helps having somebody from the outside looking in as well. You know, definitely. Yeah, obviously 100%. that there's four of you guys and you all have your input. But as well as that, sometimes you can get kind of lost in your own thoughts and each other's thoughts. And then just somebody, I suppose it's why, you know, when a lot of bands, you know, no matter what level you're at, no matter, you know, you have a producer to come in and record stuff, and that's kind of what they do. So having someone who's obviously a good mate of yours as well, they can kind of look at it and say, you know, do this or produce this way or use this software technique, whatever it might be, you know.
Definitely. I send every one of our mixes to Mark at some point for his feedback. And actually, the Guillotine, the track we played earlier, he did some production at the start of that as well. Some of the electronic stuff was by him. So.
Excellent.
Cool.
He's a great help. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. And just on that, when you're producing, you would do that yourselves as well. You don't, obviously the likes of that, where you're getting sort of little bits of help on this, but generally speaking, you would produce your own music. You don't get somebody else to, you don't send it off to somebody, would you? Or what way would you do it?
We send it off to be mixed. So yeah, that would be handled by someone else. But in terms of production, like, you know, the arrangements and how we actually approach recording the song, we mostly handle that.
Excellent. Yeah. I think there's like, obviously we'd like to get better at mixing and things, but like, we understand, like, I think just to get this sort of, I suppose, the higher level of quality, we just know we're not quite there yet in terms of doing ourselves. But we, the guy we work with, we absolutely torture him. we send the tracks off and he like mixes them together, and then we're like going back and forth, you know, trying to get just tweaking things. But he's been really, really great.
Excellent.
He's been very patient with us. So yeah, it's been a very good experience.
Excellent. Oh, that's good. It's good. It's good that you can bounce that off him as well. And, you know, I have an idea about this here, and he can say yes or no, or turned up, turned down, whatever it might be, you know. And
absolutely. And I think there's an aspect to it as well. Like sometimes maybe I'll have an idea of what I want the song to sound like, or a particular part of the song. But I just can't make it happen in the, you know, in my music editing software or whatever, because I just don't really have the skill for that. But he can sort of bring it to life.
Excellent. I think that's really, well, we don't want to keep you all night either, guys. I think that's really everything we have. We don't have a lot of questions, really. Just tell us about your music. Tell us about your gigs. That's about it.
No, really enjoyed the chat. Like, really, really enjoyed the chat.
Good stuff. Kendall, anything else you want to add?
Thanks again, lads. Appreciate you taking the time with us. Enjoyed having a chat this evening.
Likewise.
Music. Keep up the good work with the music. Loving it. Keep it going.
Thanks so much. I really appreciate the support. Like, really, really means a lot.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you very much, guys.
All right. Have a good
day. Cheers. All the best.
All the best.
Good luck.
See you.
Take care.
Cheers. Boss. Thank you.
Great bunch of lads. Really good lads. Yeah.
Indeed. As I said, I've been listening to some of their tracks this last week or so, and the two songs that they picked obviously would be two of the standout ones. But some really good material out there. But yeah, I enjoyed listening to the songs again, and it's good to hear their insight on it and stuff too, which is cool.
Yeah, definitely. It's good listening to the song with them. And then they, you know, as Danny was saying there, you know, it was good that he could listen to it without thinking about all the parts as well.
Mm-hmm. As a listener, as opposed to a critique or whatever, or as an artist, I suppose. But yeah, no, that's cool.
So coming up next, we have a song by Daisy Johnson. She's a 17-year-old singer-songwriter from Belfast, and this is called Electric Butterflies.
Tell myself, relax. Is that too much to ask? I don't like these wires, the voltage getting higher. My heart's sinking so much that I'm drowning. My stomach's doing flips and my eyes are clouded. Electric butterflies are chasing me. If you try to catch them back, they will steal your sleep. Got a lot of money, but this talk is cheap. I'm a slave to the buzz in your energy. Mm-hmm. I got up and left, unplugged my TV set. Signal's getting clear, I can feel you nearer. My heart's sinking so much that I'm drowning. My stomach's doing flips and my eyes are clouded. Electric butterflies are chasing me. If you try to catch them back, they will steal your sleep. Ain't got a lot of money, but this talk is cheap. I'm a slave to the buzz and your energy. Electric butterfly.
Love that wee song.
That's a great song. So it is actually. Again, similar to Charlie Hassan and Juno Hanlon. We'll swap that around maybe. Charlie Hanlon and Juno Hassan, maybe.
Leave that bit in too.
Oh, aye, of course. Couple of great young up and coming singer songwriters.
That song by Daisy there, that was all recorded on GarageBand too.
Yes, that's right.
You know what I mean? So, like, you know, just using whatever tools, facilities available to produce something like that. Like, that's unreal.
And I don't know, maybe if my ear's tuned to this, but I think that's just a drum beat and a bass guitar. I'm really struggling to hear any other instruments on it. And if Daisy wants to get in touch and let us know, and I can say that I was right, or you can say that I was wrong.
Fair enough.
Yes, you know, some great music this evening. And again, thanks to the guys for coming in from Modern Room there. Don't forget that all the links for all the music we featured tonight will be in the description below. And as always, like and subscribe, and you'll be kept up to date with our latest episodes.
Next time around, we're going to have special guests like A Hawk. We're going to hear some music from Blackbird and Hutch. To finish tonight, we're going to have a track from a folk band from Belfast, No Oil Paintings, and a track called Winter Trees.
White winter trees covered in snow, I don't mind, I think of you now, here in the cold, you won't mind, you won't know, but I never
didn't understand that my heart was in your hands. You were so
hi guys, thanks for watching and listening to this week's episode of the Discover Music NI podcast. We really hope you enjoyed the show. You can follow us on all your favourite social media platforms. Don't forget to like and subscribe and ring that bell and you'll be keep up to date with our latest episodes. Thanks very much guys, take care.